Welcome to this tutorial. Today we are going to have a look at tax investigations. Now there's nothing that is so unique about this, only that we'll be dealing with a scenario whereby you are given a set of accounts or tax declarations, and then you're supposed to review them and then see whether they are okay or not. An alternative scenario is where you're already told that the revenue authority has reviewed the books of a company and has given an assessment of a certain amount. So yours is to review the assessment and determine whether is it okay or not. If it is not okay, if the taxman has asked the entity, the person or the company, whatever it is, to pay more than they should, then you should appeal. If the contrary is the case, then there is no need to appeal, okay? So this topic requires you to have a thorough understanding of the tax laws, okay? So the concepts are the same concepts that you've learned in your previous studies, but I just want to mention some of the key challenges that face students with regards to this topic on investigations, which is a very, very common topic. Now, there will be two types, either income tax investigations or VAT. Okay, those are the two types. So let's first look at income tax. And I'm going to look at the more complex aspects where students normally tend to drop marks. The first thing that I want to mention here is that we start with the reported profit or loss, and then we make adjustments. So even though you will be given an income statement or a statement of P&L showing sales, cost of sales, to give you GP, then you have expenses to give you your net profit, instead of you reinventing the wheel and starting from sales afresh, you just come and start with this net profit. And then you evaluate the items that are above it by looking at also the notes. You identify items that were deducted as expenses and they should not have been, and items that may have been added as other income and they should not have been. So we start with our reported net profit. And then from the reported net profit, we are going to basically add back any disallowed expenditure that had been deducted as an expense. So whether you're talking about donations to a church, or you're talking about school fees for the children of the board chairman, or any other personal things that you know of, you're going to add them back if they had been deducted. At the same time, you're going to less any allowable expenditure that had not been accounted for. So you can be told, for example, in the additional information, that in addition to the expenses that are there, we have the following, and you can be given, for example, things like capital allowances, for example, or any other expense. So if you are given any of those relevant expenses that had not been included in generating the net profit, then you're supposed to less them. So I'm going to give the example of capital deductions, but it doesn't have to be the only one. You'll be guided by the information that is given to you in the additional information section. What about the other income? You may be given non-business income that had been added, so you need to less non-business or non-taxable income that had already been added. in generating your net profit. Okay, so when you do that, you basically get what your taxable profit or loss is. Okay, the correct, this is the adjusted. Now, there are some scenarios, especially when you are dealing with incomplete records, where you don't even have the statement of P&L. You don't have that. So how do you determine the net profit that you will start with? So in such cases where you're dealing with incomplete records, then you have to look at the movement in net assets. And the concept is very simple. If between two dates you have net assets of a certain amount, let's assume 50, and then here the net assets become 70, it is assumed that the increase is due to profit. So this becomes your starting point for this. And then you now start making these adjustments. Remember, net assets, and this should be common from your previous studies in financial reporting, net assets is total assets minus total liabilities. Okay? Now, in case you're dealing with individuals, you will be looking at total assets and total liabilities, both business and private. Okay? So you look at everything that a person has, you list down all their assets, get the figure, then list down all their liabilities, get the figure, say total assets minus total liabilities, you get your net assets. And then look at the net assets between the any two dates that you will be given, then you will get that is your opening net profit. Okay, great. Now, I just want to mention also that when you are now dealing with this working here, there are some few tricks that the examiner throws your way. And what are some of these tricks? Let's have a look at them. You see, when you're saying, for example, we less allowable expenditure, one of the key ones that poses a challenge for many students is the concept of mortgage interest. Now, if as an individual you have acquired a house and you occupy that house and you've taken a loan from any of the financial institutions and you're paying interest, then that interest is an allowable expenditure. But there's a caveat. The interest that you pay is only allowable up to a maximum of 150,000 per annum is allowable as a deduction. You're allowed to deduct it. Remember that this one was amended by the recent Finance Act. So from 1st January 2017 onwards, the limit is now 300,000. So you are allowed to deduct that. The key thing is to note that this means up to. So if you're told that you have a loan that is at 10% and the loan is valued at, let's assume, 1 million, then it means that your interest is 100,000. So the maximum deduction that you'll be allowed to deduct is 100. But supposing your loan was 2 million, so 10% times 2 million gives you 200,000. So in such a case, subject to this limit, then it means that you shall only allow up to 150 only. Okay, so remember to adjust for this once. The examiner will give guidance that we have now started using the most recent rates because there's usually a time lag between when an act becomes enacted when it becomes now examinable by CASNEB. Yeah? So, assuming we are still using the old rates of 150,000, then it means that for this one, only recognize up to 150. So the extra 50 will not be an allowed expenditure. So what I have noted many students doing is they compute the mortgage interest, and then either they ask to deduct the entire 200,000, which is wrong, or in cases where the interest is actually less than the 150, they still give a blanket of 150. Now, these are the people who have just crammed the limit of 150, so they don't know. Remember, the 150 is a maximum. It is not a minimum. So if your interest is less than 150, take the lesser off. But if it's bigger than 150, then take the maximum off, 150. That's very, very important. The other concept is, going back here, let's look at the other income. Now, under other income, we normally have several challenges that face our candidates in the exam. Now, I want to talk, first of all, about interest. Now, interest is subjected to withholding tax. Okay, at the prescribed rates. Now, if the interest is being paid to an individual, so let's assume your bank has given you interest and you've earned interest, then if as an individual you receive interest, the withholding tax that will have been deducted is final tax. Meaning that it is not taxed again. So at times you find a student coming and adding that dividend to the other revenues of the individual and taxing them on that. It should not happen. So if withholding tax has already been deducted, that's that. Do not bother taxing that interest again. However, when you're dealing with a corporation, as a company, for example, then withholding tax is not necessarily final tax, unless, of course, you're talking about qualifying dividends. Now, if you're dealing with qualifying dividends, if you're dealing with qualifying interest, then the withholding tax is final. But in all other cases, if it is non-qualifying, then we say that the withholding tax is not final tax. What does that mean? Let's look at a simplified illustration. So you are entity A, so A Limited. You have received interest of 85 from a certain bank. Let's call this Barclays Bank. It has paid you interest of 85. What does that mean? It means that Barclays Bank has retained withholding tax at, let's say, 15%, okay? So meaning that the gross interest was actually 100. They withheld 15% of 100, which was 15, and then they paid you the 85. So as A Limited, you have received income of 85. Now, since the withholding tax is not final tax in this scenario, what will happen is you will take that amount, gross it up, so you will gross up the interest, so you want it gross off withholding tax, which is basically 85 times 100 over 85, which gives you 100. And then you're going to tax it at corporate tax rates, which is 30%, which gives you 30. So you get your profit of 70, yeah? After tax. Yeah? But now, from this tax of 30, you're going to be given credit for withholding tax already deducted. Meaning that the taxman will say that, you see, you should pay me 30, but Barclays had already withheld 15, so now pay me the extra. So the revenue authority will say they want the extra 15 on top. Okay. Now, this, as I want to insist, is only applicable when you're dealing with corporations. So if you're dealing with individuals and then you see that an individual has received interest, don't subject it to further tax. But if you're dealing with a corporation, then in most cases, you'll have to subject it to further tax and then give credit for withholding tax already deducted. Let's go back to the original and look at something else that also poses challenges. Now, here, under capital deductions, there are some tricks that the examiner can bring your way. Let's have a look at them. When you're looking at capital deductions, and you'll remember that we have various types of deductions. We have the investment deduction. We have the shipping investment deduction. Or allowance. Okay, that terminology is also used. Then we have industrial building deduction or allowance. Okay. Actually, the more current terminology is now allowances. Yeah? And then we have wear and tear. Okay. So, concepts are quite straightforward from your basic studies of tax. I just want to mention some key things that the examiner likes bringing your way. I want us to first of all look at wear and tear allowances. Now, with regards to wear and tear, the examiner will always give you the various classes. Class 1, class 2, class 3, and class 4. Okay, so let's use this numerals, class 2. Okay, and the rates are always given to us. These are always given to you in the exam. So there is nothing that is technical there. We'll also be told that for software, it is at 20%. Now, the main challenge that the examiner may bring, first of all, and many students fall for this, has to do with the saloon car, the restriction. Now, saloon cars are normally in class number 3. However, the examiner allows you up to 2 million per vehicle only. What do we mean? If I buy a saloon car and it has a cost of 1 million, if this is a cost, then my wear and tear will be 25% of 1 million, which basically gives you 250,000 as being your wear and tear, and your net book value, of course, becomes 750. However, if you are told that we bought a saloon car at 3 million, you cannot come and say that your wear and tear is at 25% of 3 million. No, it is not allowed. If the saloon car is valued at more than 2 million, then you are going to assume that it was 2 million. So that is going to be your limitation. So wear and tear at 25% of the 2 million, which basically gives you 500,000. So this is the maximum you will ever claim under this when you're dealing with saloon cars. Remember, this does not affect industrial or commercial vehicles. The other trick that the examiner is fond of bringing your way is about lorries. Now, the Act stipulates that when you're dealing with class 1, you're dealing with heavy, self-propelling vehicles. while class 3 is for others. Now, it might be other self-propelling. Yeah? Now, while it might be easy for you to determine that a saloon car is class 3, the same may not apply for bigger vehicles like lorries. So, a lorry, if it exceeds some tonnage, will be assumed to be a heavy, and thus will fall under class 1. But if it's a small one, a canter or whatever it is, half a ton or such small figures, will then fall under class 3. You have to watch out for the changing rates, that are given as the minimum tonnage for each, for it to qualify as class 1. Okay, otherwise the default will now be to class 3. Great. Finally, I want you to remember that wear and tear is based on year end written down values. So it means that I may have had assets at this date. I bought, I disposed, etc. All these don't bother me as much as this one. So my wear and tear will be based on what is my net book value as at this. And this net book value is the net book value after the wear and tear. That's very, very important. Another scenario that is very popular with the examiner is where he tells you that we have made erroneous deductions. So, you may be told that we are now in year 3, for example, and you're told that we have deducted something in error. So if I told you, for example, that we have a car that is now at 500, then I tell you that whatever we had deducted here was wrong. We should not have deducted it. How then would you get back to the opening position? The first thing you have to know is that a car falls under class 3, meaning that you must have deducted 25, 25, 25, etc. But also, you should have remembered that if you're dealing with wear and tear, it is based on reducing balances. So, it is not enough for you to just say that we are now in year 3, so you have deducted 75% of the value. No, that does not work. You therefore have to realize that you are using the reducing balance method. So, it's a matter of saying that the value that we have now, 500,000, is based on the cost, which was X, multiplied by 1 minus 0.25 to power 3. We have been deducting 25% each year. So by working backwards, you can now be able to get what was the historical cost. And then, based on that, you can know what are the wear and tear allowances that you had erroneously computed. But supposing we are dealing with other deductions, for example, we can be dealing with industrial building deduction. If you are told that you have industrial building deduction that had been deducted in error, and you're told that the building is now valued at 3 million, and then you're asked, what is the value as at the initial date before you made this erroneous IBD deduction? What you just do is very simple. You know that the IBD is on the straight line basis. And if you're dealing with 10%, 10%, 10%, it just means that this 3 million represents 70%. So what is 100%? So just cross multiply. So 3 times 100 over 70 will give you the value as at this date. Then based on that, now you can be able then now to determine what had been erroneously computed, for example. So you have to watch out for such cases, the examiner is very, very conscious of some of these things, and you also have to be conscious of the fine print. Ensure you read the fine print. So with that, we are basically done with the first bit that I wanted us to look at. Okay. Let's now look at the aspect of VAT. When you're asked to do investigations or to ascertain what the correct amount is, how do you work it out? So the first thing you should remember is that with regards to VAT, we just basically say output VAT minus input VAT should give you your payable. And this one should be clear, yeah, even from your previous studies. Now, the tricks that the examiner likes bringing your way are, number one, the examiner will often give you VAT inclusive figures. Now, whenever you are determining your tax position, you should always use the VAT exclusive figures, because VAT is not your expense. So if you are, for example, told that you have made sales of 12 million and this is VAT inclusive, then you have to isolate and find out what the VAT figure is. So it's just a matter of saying that 12 million is 116%. So what is the VAT at 16? It therefore means that if I'm looking for VAT, all I need to do is use the factor 16 over 116 if I'm looking for VAT. However, if I'm looking for the base, whether the base is sales or the base is purchases, and I'm looking for the VAT exclusive amounts, all I'll do is I'll just, instead of 16 here, I'll ask for what is the amount without VAT, which is 100%. So it means that the base that I use is times 100 over 116. So depending on what you're looking at, you'll usually find yourself using either of these two, 16 over 116 or 100 over 116. If, however, the examiner is very clear that the figures are VAT exclusive, they have not yet factored in VAT, then you'll just do 16 over 100. Okay? So just be aware that there are some scenarios where you may be required to use 16 over 100, and other scenarios, 16 over 116. Yeah? Very common examiner's trick. The other one is that with regards to input VAT, it is only allowable if it has supporting documents. And by supporting documents, there must be some physical receipts, ETRs and the like. If you don't have that, then it is not an allowed input VAT. So it should be disallowed. Let's talk about imports. Imports pose a significant challenge to students. Supposing you're told that we have imported goods which have a cost, insurance and freight value of, let's assume, 5 million. Or let's work with simple numbers, 5,000. And then you're told that there is customs duty at, let's assume, 20%. Then you're told that there is VAT at 16%. And then you're told there are other charges at the port, of let's assume 1,000. The question then becomes, at what amount are we going to charge our input VAT? And it's very clear, VAT cannot be based on the 15. Rather, customs duty takes precedence. So it means that you should first take cost, insurance, freight, 5,000, and then you add customs, which is 20% of 5,000, which gives you 1,000, which gives you 6,000, And then, do not include these other charges first, but rather now charge VAT on this. So, in our scenario here, we have 0.16 times that, which basically gives you 960. So, we get 6960. This is a VAT inclusive amount. Now, to this one, you can now come and add other charges, yeah? So, let's say that this port charges of 1,000. So, then now you can see that your total cost is now 7960. Now, in case you are told, for example, that we normally sell our goods at a markup of 10%, it means that from this total cost here, we add a markup. But remember, this is inclusive of VAT, and VAT is not your cost. So it means that when you're determining your output VAT, what you should do is you look at the vertible cost, which was 6,000 here, the amount before VAT, and then you add other costs. So for example, this port clearing, which was 1,000, which gave you 7,000. And then you add your markup at 10%, which gives you 700. And then now, this is your selling price exclusive of VAT. So now you can add VAT on this one. So what does this give you? Gives you 1232. So it means that your selling price is now 8932. So if you are to determine what is your VAT on these imports, we'll just look at output VAT 1232 minus input VAT 960. And this would give you your VAT on those imports. Okay. So this poses significant challenges to many students. You normally find students adding up, and once they get the total cost here, 79, they add the markup on this, and then they get the VAT on this, which is very wrong. Remember, when you're looking for your output VAT, base it on your vertible cost, the amount before VAT. You cannot have VAT on VAT, okay? Great. And that basically now summarizes the key highlights. Of course, you should have a nice understanding from the basic studies of how the two systems of income tax and VAT operate. All I've done in this session is just to highlight some of the key tricks that the examiner normally uses. So it presupposes that you already have a basic understanding of the other aspects of these two acts. This brings us to an end of this